Hello, everyone. Welcome. Thank you for joining us for today's Deck Out a Trout session with Bow Habitat Station. Our session is going to begin shortly in the next 2 minutes. We just wanted to let you know we're going to be using the Q&A box throughout our session. So if you'd like to open it up and practice using it, please tell us what grade you're joining us from. We're going to get started here in the next 2 minutes. All right, everyone. So welcome. It's time to get started with our session here this afternoon. We do have a quick video to show you introducing us all to the Calgary Mayor's Expo. So let's have a watch.
Hi, it's Mayor Nahidnenshi here. And you know, normally the first week of June is one of my favorite times of year to be at City Hall because the Mayor's Environment Expo takes over the whole place. Hundreds of students and teachers and parents and exhibitors all talking about how we can keep our land, our air, and our water clean and safe for everyone. Of course, it's a little different this year again because we can't be together. But nonetheless, so many folks have worked so hard to make sure that you have the opportunity to still have a great Mayor's Environment Expo and to learn about all the ways that you can help the environment. So a special thank you to all of my colleagues at the City of Calgary who come together to put this on. A thank you to our venue partners at the Calgary Public Library and the University of Calgary School of Architecture, Planning and Landscape for putting this all together. Et je comprends aussi qu'il y a des sessions en français cette année et c'est merveilleux, bravo pour étudier en français et pour apprendre toutes les choses qu'on peut faire pour améliorer l'environnement. And my best thanks, of course, go to the teachers who've worked hard to make this work within their crazy world of changing how they teach, and especially a thank you to all of the students involved. I know this has been a really rough year. I know that we've had to learn completely new ways of doing things and new ways of learning, but I also know that young people have shown that they are truly resilient, that students are focusing on what really matters and how we move forward. And especially in this time of climate change, one of the things that really matters is all of our responsibility to the environment. So have a great virtual Mayor's Environment Expo, everyone.
Hello, everyone. Today is a very special day. We are celebrating Clean Air Day. In 1999, Canada declared Clean Air Day to be an annual celebration during Environment Week, which is the first week of June every year. The Calgary Region Airshed Zone, or CRAZ, wants to celebrate with you today by sharing some information about our airshed in Calgary. On average, the air quality in Calgary is good, except on smoky wildfire days and weather inversions, which can cause a buildup of pollution. Did you know it is important to monitor air quality to make sure our air is healthy for everyone to breathe? CRAZ monitors the air quality with air quality monitoring stations around the city for all the people living in Calgary. CRAZ works hard to ensure that everyone that lives in this region cares about the air. As students, you can help too by riding a bike or scooter or walking to school. reminding adults to turn their vehicles off if they are waiting for you at school, turning off the lights when you leave a room, your class, or your house, and reducing idling at drive-thrus, or not even using the drive-thrus at all. Thank you to Mayor Nenshi and the City of Calgary for recognizing how important clean air is to Calgarians. And thank you, students, for caring for our air. We hope you have a great Environment Week.
Awesome. Well, thank you. Happy Clean Air Day, everyone, and welcome to the Calgary Mayor's Expo Deck Out a Trout session from Bow Habitat Station. I'm Kate, and I'm going to be your presenter today. We also have Robin from Bow Habitat Station joining us. She will be our moderator for the question and answer periods. So please put your questions or have your teacher put your questions in the Q&A box. We have quite a few students joining us today, so we are going to be doing our best to answer as many questions as we can during our 1 hour together.
Hi everyone, you can't see me, but my name is Robin and you'll be hearing me throughout our session today. I've already started sending out some announcements in the Q&A, and later in our session, we're going to work through a couple of activities together. So if you don't have a copy of the worksheet for this program in front of you already, you can either find a blank piece of paper and something to draw with, or you can click the link that I shared and open it up on your computer to fill it out online. If you have any issues, you can send me a note in the Q&A.
Awesome. Thanks so much, Robin. So Bow Habitat Station is an environmental education center here in Calgary where you can learn all about Alberta's air, land, water, and biodiversity. And we know that learning more about the environment where we live is the first step in becoming an environmental steward or someone who thinks, plans, and acts with the environment in mind. Bow Habitat Station is located on the banks of the Bow River, just downstream from where the Elbow and Bow Rivers meet. And this has been a special place because it has been a meeting place long before we were here. So we would like to acknowledge that what we call Alberta is the traditional and ancestral territory of many peoples, presently subject to Treaties 6, 7, and 8. This includes the Métis settlement and the six regions of the Métis Nation of Alberta within the historical Northwest Métis land. Let us acknowledge the many First Nations and Métis people whose footsteps, gatherings have marked these lands for centuries. Let us honor and show respect to the elders past, present, and future, and to all of the Indigenous peoples of the regions that we find ourselves today. So today we're going to swim alongside some of Alberta's fish to see how they navigate environmental change. Let's dive in. Alberta is home to 66 different species of fish. Each of them have unique characteristics and adaptations that help them survive life in the water. We are going to be using the terms characteristics and adaptations many times during our session today. So let's review their definitions. Characteristics are words we would use to describe the way that a fish looks or how they behave. So if you were to describe some of my physical characteristics, you would say I have long hair and that I wear glasses. Adaptations are characteristics that help a fish survive in its habitat. Now that we have reviewed the meaning of the word characteristic, could you all describe the characteristics of the northern pike you see on your screen? Let's use the Q&A box to describe the characteristics you see. Type them in there or let your teacher know and they can type them in the Q&A box there for you.
All right, Kate, we're getting some great observations coming in. Someone says it looks like our fish has a flap on the side of its head, kind of just behind its eye, and that those eyes are pretty small and black.
So those are awesome characteristics you've observed. Great job. So I like that you are putting lots of detail into your characteristics there, describing the size of the eyes, the color of the eyes, also that flap maybe on the side of their face. Those would be their gills that you're seeing. Nice observations.
Some folks have noticed the patterns on this fish. In addition to the fish being kind of silvery, it has some stripes and maybe even some spots.
Nice work. Yeah, so we're describing the colors and the patterns that we're seeing on our northern pike scales. So for sure, we could describe maybe their colors are looking a little silvery on their bellies. Maybe the colors are also looking different on the tops of the fish.
Someone says this fish is kind of triangular shaped, especially on its front jaw there.
Oh, nice work. So you're describing the shape of their mouth and their nose.
Someone else said this fish looks pretty slim and streamlined.
Oh, that's a very interesting observation. Absolutely. So a great characteristic is we can describe the shape of our pike, and long and streamlined and slender are great characteristics to describe that.
Folks have been seeing lots of scales and lots of fins on this fish.
Nice work. That's another great observation. They do have fins. Kind of hard to tell how many fins they have by this picture, but we'll see a different one in just a moment.
And some folks have said it kind of looks like they have a beak, almost like a duck, on the front of their face.
Oh, that's a really interesting observation, and it sounds like you're finding some similarities between our northern pike's shape of its mouth and the shape of a bird beak. Nice work. Awesome. So great job, guys, describing all of those interesting characteristics. So now let's see if any of the northern pike's characteristics are adaptations that would help them to survive in their habitat. So from the characteristics we all just described together, are there any of them that you think would help them to survive? So if you have any answers, just put them there in the Q&A box, or have your teacher put them in the Q&A box there, and we can go over them together.
So some folks are saying that they have really big mouths to be able to hunt and eat a lot.
Ah, you got it, absolutely. So our northern pike is a huge predator in its habitat, which would mean that it is eating a lot of different things. So our northern pike actually likes to eat other fish and will even eat ducklings in the water. So they need that long, slender mouth to be able to do that. Nice work. That's absolutely going to help them survive.
Someone else said their fins help them to move.
You guys got it, absolutely. So all of those fins on our northern pike is an adaptation that helps it to survive, because fins allow our fish to move faster in the water and to navigate the water better as well. So that'll help them to survive.
Perfect. And a lot of folks are saying that the colors and patterns might help it to camouflage.
Ah, nice observations. Absolutely. So the colors and the patterns on our northern pike are an adaptation as well. If we have a close look at the picture there of the fish on your screen, you can see that they have olivey green, yellow, silver colors to their scales. And there's that pattern there of lines or dots. And then if you look behind the pike at its environment, they're very similar, which would allow it to camouflage really easily, which would allow it to survive better. Nice job, you guys.
So a lot of people have said that they have gills that allow them to breathe underwater and specialized eyes that allow them to see underneath the water.
Nice work, everyone. Absolutely. Our gills are an adaptation on all of our fish species that allow them to get oxygen out of the water, which allows them to survive in their water environment. And the shape and size of their eyes, for sure. So nice job, everyone. So what we'd like to do now is actually take a look at some different types of fish that live here in Alberta and have a look at what their adaptations are. So what allows them to survive in their environment as well. So we're going to have a look here at our first fish, the Arctic grayling. The Arctic grayling has that big, colorful dorsal fin, which is the fin on the top of its back. And that big, colorful dorsal fin actually allows the fish to attract mates when it's ready to reproduce young, and it would also warn off predators. So if a predator was swimming by and saw this big, colorful dorsal fin, it might get scared and it might swim away, which would allow our Arctic grayling to survive. Next, we have our walleye. And our walleye is a really interesting Albertan fish. You can see there that the walleye has really dark, reflective eyes. And that's one of its adaptations because it allows our fish to see in its dark and murky habitat. So the walleye live in an environment where the water is really dark and murky. And with those reflective eyes, it actually enables the fish to see its prey in that murky water. And then our last fish there on the bottom is our lake sturgeon. And our lake sturgeon has some really interesting adaptations that help it to survive. One of its adaptations are those whiskers you see on the bottom of its face. And those whiskers actually have taste buds on them that allow the lake sturgeon to drag them along the bottom of its habitat to find food. So it can taste its food as it's dragging them along the bottom of the water. It also has a downward facing mouth so that it can easily take in food that it finds as it's swimming along the bottom of its habitat. And then next, it has, our lake sturgeon doesn't have any scales. What it actually has is a leathery skin, which helps to protect it. And that's because the lake sturgeon is a prehistoric fish. So it's actually been around since the time of the dinosaurs. And really interesting, everyone, lake sturgeon can live to be over 100 years old. They are a very interesting fish. So before we move on, does anyone have any questions about the topics that we've covered so far? If you do, just put them there in the Q&A box.
So Kate, somebody's been asking, how fast does a northern pike swim?
Oh, you know what? I know the answer to this one. A northern pike, you guys, is a very quick swimmer. A northern pike can actually swim faster than an Olympic swimmer. They are very quick swimmers, which allows them to be a big predator in their habitat. They can swim quickly to eat many different things like fish.
And do northern pikes swim in schools or do they swim alone?
So I believe that northern pike swim alone. They are not a fish that likes to be around other fish.
And Kate, do you know why that might be?
Probably because they are searching for a lot of food to eat and they don't want any competition around them. Awesome questions.
Can you once again tell us the names of all the fish that we see on screen here?
Absolutely. So this fish right here with these silvery scales, this is our Arctic grayling. And our Arctic grayling like really cool, clean, clear water. And so we find this fish species more in the mountains. And then we have our walleye fish right here. And our walleye live in northern Alberta. And they like a habitat that has that dark, murky water. And then our fish here on the bottom, this is our lake sturgeon. And our lake sturgeon usually are found in the river system in Alberta, but we can find some in lakes as well.
And how many whiskers does a lake sturgeon have?
They have 4 whiskers.
How long are northern pike?
So northern pike grow to the size of their environment. So the northern pike, we actually have some here at Bow Habitat Station downstairs in our aquariums. And because they live in an aquarium, they can only grow to be a size that's right to be living in that habitat. If we saw a northern pike that was out in a lake or a river, that fish could grow to be maybe like 40 centimeters long, a really large, large fish because it can grow to be the size of its habitat.
Perfect. And Kate, what do lake sturgeon like to eat?
Lake sturgeon like to eat plants. So that's what they're looking for. And our Arctic grayling and our walleye that you see on your screen, they actually like to eat insects and other fish.
Perfect. And why does that walleye have spikes on one of its fins?
Oh, well, that's a really cool observation that someone's seeing, and that's actually a characteristic and an adaptation as well of our walleye. So our walleye has a dorsal fin, which is actually the fin that's closer to its tail. And then that other fin, they actually use for protection. So it's not really a fin. It has these bones and spiky things coming off of it. And so that's if a predator were to come near it and maybe bite it, it would be able to poke that predator and maybe that predator would let it go. So it's a really cool adaptation that helps them to survive.
Kate, can any of these fish we see on screen drown?
No, so fish are adapted, which means they survive in a water environment.
Perfect, and one last question maybe before we move on. Do we know if any of the fish we see on screen are related to each other?
I don't believe that they are. They all come from different families.
Perfect.
Nice work, everyone. So everyone, in just a moment, we're going to have a look at a video of some trout swimming downstairs at the Bow Habitat Station aquariums. And in Alberta, we actually have 8 trout species here, and they all have similar characteristics. So they all have 8 fins, colorful scales, eyes on the side of their head, and an adipose fin. So that adipose fin is this fin right here on the middle of the back of the fish in between their dorsal and their tail fin. So as we're watching this video of rainbow trout swimming downstairs in the aquariums, I would like everyone to brainstorm how the similar characteristics that we just talked about in trout species could be adaptations that help them to survive. So I just want to let everyone know this video does not have any sound. It's just a video of our fish swimming down in the aquariums.
Somebody noticed that these fish don't have any of those whiskers on their chins.
Absolutely. They don't have that characteristic or that adaptation. So our rainbow trout are actually using their different senses to find their food. So they're looking for food, they're smelling for food, they also feel vibrations in the water to find their food.
Somebody else noticed that these fish have some red or pink on their sides.
Yeah, absolutely. So their colorful scales are a characteristic as well as an adaptation. So when an adult rainbow trout is ready to reproduce young, that red stripe actually gets really, really, really red, and it will attract mates to it so that it can reproduce young.
Someone says these fish look like they're pretty old because they're so big.
Oh, that's an interesting observation. So the fish that we're seeing down here in the aquariums, they're around 5 years old, and rainbow trout out in the wild can live for many more years than that. And it's really hard to actually tell how old a fish is based on its size. So one of the ways that we actually can tell the age of a fish, I believe if you take off one of their scales, and really only biologists are doing this, and you can actually count the rings or the lines on their scales, and it's kind of like learning how old a tree is.
Cool. And another group has noticed that these fish don't really have those spikes on their fins like the walleye do, and their noses are way more curved than some of the other fish we saw.
Oh, those are 2 really great observations. Absolutely. So our rainbow trout, they do not have that spiky scale that may help to protect them. So our rainbow trout, to get away from predators, they are really good swimmers. They're really good at navigating and swimming quickly in the water. So that's how they're going to protect themselves from predators. And also, you notice their shape of their nose, and that's actually a characteristic that we can use to see the difference between male and female fish.
Kate, somebody noticed that these fish aren't making sounds. Is that common for fish not to make any sounds?
Yeah, absolutely. Our fish do not talk to one another like we talk to one another, but they can communicate in different ways. Our aquariums downstairs are a pretty quiet place to be.
Some other groups have said these fish have a really big fin and pretty small eyes.
Awesome, absolutely. So those are also really good characteristics. So those big fins, like we've talked about, allow our trout species to swim quickly and navigate the water really well as well. Nice work, everyone. Good job on describing all of those adaptations that our trout species could have. So rainbow trout, like we just discussed, they have a lot of adaptations that allow them to survive in lakes and rivers throughout Alberta. And some of the characteristics that we described that could be also adaptations are, like we talked about, their eight fins that allow them to navigate the water quickly, allow them to be swift swimmers, so that our trout species can eat other fish or insects. Our trout species in Alberta are all huge predators that are going to be eating other fish and insects in the water. Also, another one of their really interesting adaptations, something that helps them to survive, is that adipose fin. And so that adipose fin, there isn't a lot known about that fin just right now, but some recent research has told us that that fin actually senses the fish's environment. So it's kind of acting like a weather station. So it can actually measure pressure in the water. It could also measure water currents, as well as changing temperatures in the water, which are all going to help the trout species survive. And someone else had described their body shape. The trout's body shape being long and slender allow them to slip quickly through the water with really little resistance. And they also have that forward-facing mouth, which is a little bit different than the lake sturgeon that we saw earlier. And that forward-facing mouth allows our rainbow trout to eat as it's swimming in the open water. So we're going to dive in here and talk a little bit more about adaptations. Specifically, we're going to be talking about this adipose fin on our trout species. So our trout species maybe didn't always have this adipose fin. It could be an adaptation that has developed over time to allow our fish species to survive. So we know that adaptations happen very slowly and over a long period of time, usually generations or years, to become common characteristics of that animal. So if we have a look here to see maybe how that adipose fin developed on our trout species, we can have a look here at, on your screen, you have a parent trout there at the top and some of their young below it. And only one of that young species has an adipose fin, was born with that adipose fin. And that one young that was born with that adipose fin is going to have a better chance of surviving than the other young. Maybe it would help it swim faster away from that northern pike. We also know that the adipose fin helps with measuring water temperature and water current, so it will also help it survive that way. And so you can see that when that young that was born with that adipose fin becomes a parent and is ready to have young of its own, it passes that gene down to its young, and its young will be born with that adipose fin. And eventually, over generations, sometimes taking hundreds of years, the species as a whole will all gain this new adaptation. Just like we have right here on your screen. So we can now see a picture today of the Athabasca rainbow trout and what they look like today. You can see there that they're born with that adipose fin. They all have the other common characteristics of a trout, like the eight fins, the colorful scales, the eyes on the sides of their heads. And Athabasca rainbow trout, they all have these different adaptations that allow them to survive in their habitat.
Kate, we have a few questions about Athabasca rainbow trout. Do trout mate for life?
Oh, that's a really great question. You know what? They don't mate for life. So when a rainbow trout reaches 2 years of age, that's when they reproduce young, the female is going to lay a nest. And so what they do is they actually make a red, it's called, in the gravel of their habitat, and they lay over 5,000 eggs. And then the male fish will swim over and fertilize all of those eggs.
And what do those eggs look like?
Oh, another really interesting question. So if everyone takes their pinky finger and has a look at the nail on their pinky finger, that's the size of a rainbow trout egg, and they are really orange in color.
And do rainbow trout school together?
They do school together. So rainbow trout like to be around other rainbow trout.
And what do rainbow trout eat?
Rainbow trout are carnivores, so they are going to be eating other fish. They are going to be eating aquatic invertebrates, which means water insects.
And why are they called rainbow?
So you know what? I don't know if people really know why they're called rainbow, but I think that we can take a really educated guess and know that they have all of those beautiful colors on their scales. We can see the top half of their body has that maybe olivey green. Their fins have some yellow in them. They have that beautiful red line. Their bellies are silver. They have all of those black dots all around them. So they have lots of colors of the rainbow where they probably get their name from.
And one more question before we move on here, Kate. Do fish have a good sense of smell?
Yeah, absolutely. So fish can smell in their environment, and that's one of the senses that they're using to find their food.
Perfect. Awesome. Thanks.
No problem. So a habitat, we know, is a place or an environment where a plant or animal makes its home. And all healthy habitats have four key components. They have food, water, shelter, and space. So all of Alberta's fish live in cool, cold water, but some fish, as we learned about before, prefer murky water to live in, whereas others need clear water to survive. So to live in these different habitats, fish would need different characteristics or adaptations to be able to survive in these different habitats. So we're now going to take a focus on the Athabasca rainbow trout and its habitat range. So on your screen there, you see a really big picture of Alberta. And the Athabasca rainbow trout we find here in Alberta, they are one of our native fish species, which means they have been in Alberta for forever. And this fish species lives in the upper half of the Athabasca watershed. So right there. So Athabasca rainbow trout were once abundant in this habitat range, meaning there were lots of them living in that area. But today, there are actually very few Athabasca rainbow trout left in our province. So what I would like us to do next is, using the Q&A box, could you let us know why you think the number of Athabasca rainbow trout living in Alberta has decreased? Why do you think there aren't as many Athabasca rainbow trout living in that habitat range?
All right, some folks think that maybe they've all been fished out, or maybe there's just other predators in the area.
Those are really awesome suggestions, absolutely. If there were new predators that wanted to eat the Athabasca rainbow trout, that wouldn't help with their survival. Also, if they were overfished, there wouldn't be as many of them.
And someone else said maybe there's a lot of pollution where they live, or maybe they just migrated somewhere else.
Those are also really good suggestions. So if there was pollution in their habitat, maybe they wouldn't be living in a very healthy habitat anymore, which wouldn't allow them to survive. So that's an awesome suggestion. Maybe they migrated. That's another guess.
We had a few more comments that maybe humans were taking up their space and the fish got scared.
Ooh, well, that's an interesting one. So you're right. Maybe there were cities or buildings built in or around the fish's habitat that would scare them away. They weren't used to that. Maybe all of that building added pollution into their habitat.
Somebody else said that maybe the water was getting hotter.
Oh, well, that's really interesting. And that leads us great into this slide right here. So the reason for the decline in numbers of Athabasca rainbow trout in their habitat is actually changes to their environment. And what you guys described are all changes that can happen in an Athabasca rainbow trout's environment. And we know that some of these changes are natural, while others are human-made. So the main reason for the decline in the number of Athabasca rainbow trout in their habitat is a change to their environment, either natural or human-made. So you guys, now it's time for you to take out your Deck Out a Trout worksheet. If you don't have a Deck Out a Trout worksheet in front of you, don't worry about it. Grab a blank piece of paper and a pencil and you can follow along with us as well. So on the top half of your worksheet, there are going to be some circles. And in those circles are environmental changes that the Athabasca rainbow trout are facing. If you guys can think of any other environmental changes you think they might be facing, just add them right beside as well. So let's go over some of these changes together. So we have changes to their environment like less water and less oxygen. And we can call those water quality changes. So if there was less water, which would mean there would be less oxygen for our fish, they're not going to be able to survive, or the amount of them in that habitat range are not going to be able to survive. We also have an environmental change of warmer water. So like we learned about before, all fish species in Alberta like to live in cool or cold water. And that's because we don't have any hot water lakes or hot water rivers in our province. So they need to live in water that's cool and cold. That's what they have been adapted to. That's what they survive in. Next, we have environmental changes like new diseases. And an example of this can be whirling disease that was found in southern Alberta, and that actually affected trout species here in our province. And when that new disease was introduced, our trout species, unfortunately, some of them couldn't survive that new disease that was found. We also have things like new predators that could be added to their habitat, so either on purpose or accidentally. So if a new predator came into a habitat, it would either eat the Athabasca rainbow trout, or it might like the same habitat and it could kick the Athabasca rainbow trout out of its habitat because the Athabasca rainbow trout doesn't want to get eaten. And then next, what if the water became muddier? So we know that our Athabasca rainbow trout, they don't have those dark reflective eyes like the walleye we had discussed earlier. So if they can't see through that muddy water to find fish or insects to eat, they also wouldn't be able to survive. So for everyone, can fish stop these changes from happening? What do you guys think? Can fish stop environmental changes from happening? No, absolutely not. But can we stop these changes from happening? Well, yeah, sometimes we can. And there are some things that we can do to protect fish's habitat, or we can help to slow down some of those changes. And we know that even small changes in an environment can have a big impact on the plants and animals that are living in that habitat. So what I'd like us to do together next is on your worksheet, you're going to see those squares on your page. And those squares have the impacts to the fish in them. So what we're going to do is I'd like everybody to take a couple of minutes to match the changes in the environment, which are the circles, to the impacts that they could have on the fish, which are in the boxes there. So some of the environmental changes, they might actually impact the fish in more than a couple of ways. So what you can do is you can just draw lines from the circles to the squares, connecting the environmental changes with the impacts you think are related. So as you guys are connecting environmental changes with impacts, you can use the Q&A box and let us know which ones you've connected.
So somebody has already connected more predators to maybe stressing the fish out and also making predators could make them sick or even eat them so that those fish wouldn't survive.
Absolutely. Those are two really great connections. For sure. We talked about if a new predator was put into a Athabasca rainbow trout's environment, who knows, it might be a predator of the Athabasca rainbow trout and eat it. That wouldn't allow them to survive.
Someone else said that murky water might cause our fish stress, but also give them trouble using their senses.
Awesome. Great job on connecting the environmental changes with two impacts that might affect our Athabasca rainbow trout. So that muddy water, we know that our Athabasca rainbow trout wouldn't be able to see, and it would also stress them out if they can't see to find anything to eat. That's not going to be good for their health either.
A lot of people said that having less water and less oxygen could make it hard to breathe.
Oh, absolutely. Those are really two good connections that people are making.
Somebody else said that the fish would have trouble breathing if there was less oxygen. Absolutely.
Awesome. Nice work, everyone. So great job in making those connections. So we know that it takes fish hundreds of years to adapt and develop new characteristics and behaviors to survive changes to their environment. And that's what happens in the real world. But we're going to jump over to a fantasy world for our next activity together. And what we're going to do is we're actually going to help that trout species on your Deck Out a Trout worksheet survive those changes at the top to its environment. So what we're going to do is we're going to add adaptations onto that trout species so it can survive less water, less oxygen, warmer water, new diseases, new predators, and muddy water. And so what I'd like you guys to do is I would like you to get as creative as you can be. So these adaptations that you're adding, they can be real world objects or they can be imaginary things. We are going to help this trout survive in a fantasy world. So as you guys are putting adaptations onto your trout species, let us know what you've added in the Q&A box. So what we'd like you to do is add at least one adaptation for each one of the environmental changes that are on top of your worksheet. So we're going to take about the next 5 minutes to do this together, everyone. And if you think of any really cool adaptations, you can let Robin and I know. So one of the adaptations that I would add onto my trout to help with less water is I would actually help it grow some legs so that it could wade through the shallow water. And maybe that would help it survive.
Somebody's added goggles to their fish to help it to be able to see even when the water gets muddy.
Oh, that's awesome. That's a great adaptation.
Someone else has given their fish wings so it can still travel even if there's less water around.
Oh, that's a really creative adaptation somebody's added. I was thinking to help my fish with an environmental change of less oxygen that I would give it a snorkel to breathe oxygen from the air.
Somebody else said that for less oxygen, they'd give their fish an oxygen mask. And someone else actually added a mask to help protect their fish from diseases.
Absolutely. Those are all adaptations that are going to help the trout survive. You guys, I really like how creative everyone's getting.
We have a couple of fish out there that have laser eyes now or glow in the dark eyes, and some fish even have stronger scales.
For sure. Maybe those stronger scales are going to help protect it from predators.
And folks, just a reminder for those of you who don't have the worksheet open in front of you can just draw an outline of a fish on a blank piece of paper and then start decking it out. All right, one fish has a hole in their body to spread out ink so that they can actually get away when there's new predators around.
Oh, that sounds like another adaptation I've heard of. That's really cool.
Somebody else added a biohazard suit to protect their fish from disease or bigger lungs so they could breathe the same amount even if there's less oxygen.
Really cool. So I haven't heard of any adaptations added for warmer water yet. But I was thinking that maybe I would give my fish an umbrella so it could shade itself from really hot temperatures.
So this one's not for warmer water either, but somebody gave their fish pointy scales, and somebody else put a jet on their fish's back to help it get away from predators.
Nice.
Oh, this one would help with warmer water. Somebody put ice packs on their fish to cool it down.
A great one. Maybe today, with all of our hot temperatures, we could all use an adaptation with ice packs too to help us cool down.
Somebody else gave their fish more teeth to be able to scare predators away or maybe eat the predators that are chasing them.
That's an awesome adaptation.
All right, somebody added quite a bit to their fish. They added a bubble so predators couldn't get to them. They have grass for scales and goggles on.
Cool.
Somebody else said they would dunk their fish in a cold bath if the waters were getting too warm.
Awesome. To help with new diseases, I thought that I would give my trout a first aid kit so it could help heal itself and maybe it could help heal all the other fish species around it too.
Some of our fish have been getting vaccinations to protect against diseases.
Cool.
One fish actually got lemonade to cool them down too if the water was warmer.
Everyone is getting really creative. These are amazing adaptations that you guys are adding on to your trout species here.
Oh my goodness, Kate, one fish has maybe morphed to have stingers and urchin needles to protect themselves from predators. Nice one.
Yeah, that would help for sure. To help with new predators, I was thinking that I would give my trout the ability to become invisible. so that they wouldn't be able to be seen by those new predators in their environment.
One of our fish out there grew arms to help it swim faster. Other fish have grown more scales to protect themselves from predators.
Absolutely. To help with muddy water, I thought that maybe my trout could get a protective suit so that it would be able to breathe better. It might be able to see better. Wonderful. So if you are finished fully decking out your trout, giving it all these new adaptations, Robin and I would love to see what your trout look like. So if you wanted to, or if your teachers wanted to, you can put those worksheets on social media for us to see, and you can hashtag them with Mayor's Expo YYC or Bow Habitat Station so Robin and I can see what your trout look like all decked out. Awesome. Well, if you haven't finished decking out your trout yet, I'm sure that you're going to have some more time in just a little bit. But we want to talk about, can the things that we added to our fish be used to help them in reality, in the real world? Probably not. Not most of the ones that we came up with. And as fun as it was to brainstorm these fantasy adaptations, unfortunately, they wouldn't be able to help our fish survive. But the best thing that we can do to help trout and other fish species survive in Alberta is to help protect their environment. So this means that we should be acting, planning, and thinking with the environment in mind. And so some of the ways that the government of Alberta is helping to slow environmental change is that they are actually protecting habitats where fish have their young. So like the picture you're seeing there on your screen, we have protected areas in Alberta, and specifically protected areas where fish species are reproducing and raising their young to help protect that habitat and that environment. There is also some things being done to help repair damaged habitat. So the picture you see on your screen there is willow staking. And willow staking is like planting new trees. So willow staking could provide new tree coverage over top of a water body, which we would know would help to shade that water body, maybe keeping the water temperature cooler. Also, willow staking is really important because it stabilizes the banks of the water bodies. So that would avoid dirt and sand mixing in there with the water, making the water murky. And we know that not all fish species in Alberta are adapted to live in murky water. So that would also help. Next, we are also removing invasive species like the picture you see on your screen there. So goldfish are unfortunately an invasive species in some of our water bodies. So they are actually using up the habitat that some of our fish species need, and they're taking over that habitat, meaning that the fish that were there before can't live there anymore. So how we can help is we never want to let our aquarium species release them into water bodies. So we want to be responsible pet owners, and we don't want to let it loose. So we never want to release aquarium pets or water garden plants into any water bodies because they might have the potential to become an invasive species. And next, I want to hear what you guys are doing. What are you doing to help protect fish and fish habitat? If you guys can think of anything, put that there in the Q&A box. Robin and I want to know what you're doing to help protect the environment and fish's habitat.
So Kate, somebody said maybe they could try to go fishing for goldfish to take some of them out of the environment.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. So we don't want to go fishing for those goldfish. It's important, though, if you do see goldfish in a water body, that you do report it. And there are places that you can do that. And then the right people with the right equipment would come to that water body, and they would actually be able to remove the goldfish from that water body. That's an awesome suggestion, though.
And someone else said maybe they can do what these kids on screen are doing and pick up garbage or bottles from around a fish's home.
Yeah, for sure. So we want to respect and clean the environment as well. So when we are out exploring by a fish's habitat or anywhere in the environment, if we are taking anything with us, we always want to remember to take it back and dispose of it properly. And if we do see any litter in the environment, we can pick it up and dispose of it properly as well.
Someone else said that maybe they can plant some trees.
Yeah, that's an awesome idea to be able to plant trees. That would be great as well.
Kate, is there any way that we can clean the water for our fish?
Well, we don't want to be cleaning the water, but we can help by doing things that wouldn't pollute the water. So that's like not using fertilizers or pesticides on your lawn. It would be when you are doing oil changes on your car to remember to collect that oil and dispose of it properly. Don't let it run down into the storm drain, because all of that water that heads down our storm drains eventually makes its way into our fish's habitat.
Somebody else said that maybe they shouldn't be throwing rocks into a lake where fish live.
You know what? As fun as it is to throw rocks, that's actually something we shouldn't be doing. So we know that when we're throwing rocks, we could actually be making the water a little bit murkier for the fish to live in. And we know that maybe they wouldn't be able to survive. Another thing that we can do is we can always use pathways and bridges when we're out exploring. So when we're using pathways and bridges, it means that we aren't stepping on or stepping through fish habitats. And so if we were stepping on or stepping through fish habitats, we could be maybe accidentally stepping on a fish nest, a red, or we could be introducing dirt into the water, which we know won't help our fish species to survive.
Kate, a lot of folks are saying maybe we can do something to stop overfishing.
You know what? All of the water bodies that we have in Alberta have rules and regulations around them for fishing. So it's okay to go fishing in Alberta as long as you are following the rules and the regulations. And those rules and regulations tell us if we're allowed to go fishing at that water body, if we're allowed to keep the fish that we catch. And if we are allowed to keep the fish, they'll have to be a certain size. They'll have to be the right species for that water body. And also in Alberta, we have something called the Fish Stocking Program. So there are two provincially run fish hatcheries here in Alberta that actually raise millions of fish every single year. And those fish get put into lakes or ponds in Alberta for us to go fishing for. So as long as we're following the rules and regulations, we are allowed to be fishing here in Alberta. So another thing that we can also do to help slow environmental change is to be energy and water wise in our homes and at school. So one of the things that Robin and I are doing to be water wise at our houses is we're actually turning off the tap when we're brushing our teeth to help be water wise. Are there anything that you guys are doing at your homes or at school that you're doing to be energy and water wise?
It looks like somebody collects water when it rains in a bucket and uses that to water their garden.
Oh, that's an awesome suggestion that we can all do. Absolutely. We can all collect that rainwater, and that rainwater would be excellent to water all of our plants and our gardens at our house.
Quite a few folks turn off the water when they're washing dishes. They'll stop it partway through rather than letting it run.
Absolutely. Sounds like the same idea as when you're brushing your teeth. You don't need just to let all of that water run down the drain.
And there's a couple folks who said their parents have recently had to buy new appliances, like a new dishwasher or washing machine for their clothes, that are called high efficiency.
Yes, for sure. So that means that they are using less water when they are being used. That's an excellent way to help as well.
And there's a few folks who say they take shorter showers, or some people actually even turn the water off while they lather up the shampoo and their hair in the shower and then turn it back on to rinse.
Those are excellent ideas of how to be water wise and energy wise at your home. Great job, everyone. So everyone, we want to thank you so much for joining us today. We want you to continue exploring, have fun exploring Alberta's air, land, water, and biodiversity, and have a great rest of the Calgary Mayor's Environment Expo. Thanks for joining us. Bye.